Today I'm going to show you how I would paint feathers in both watercolor and acrylics. I'm Sara, and I make art. Looking at a reference photo and looking at a blank piece of paper, and figuring how you're going to take that reference photo and put it onto that piece of paper is always a little daunting. That's why I like to start simple. So I just painted one big shape over the side of the bird here. In the watercolor version, I just left this white. But when we paint acrylics, we cover the entire canvas. But I don't like to paint large blocks of pure white. I think it looks weird. So that's why I'm just painting with a very light gray. I'm covering up the background as best I can here, but if a little of it shows through, that's not a big deal. It'll all get covered up by the time I put all the detail and the overcolor on it anyway. The bird in my reference photo is pretty much gray, but I can see a little hint of blue in it. I'm hyping the blue up in my painting because I think that'll look better, and I'm taking artistic license. You can see now I'm drawing some of his body on with the charcoal pencil. I made a video about why I do that, and I'll put a card up and link that in the description. You'll recognize this shape from the watercolor version, which is a big massive color and a significantly darker but still pretty light shade over the surface color. And for most of this mask, I'm using the flat edge of a medium-sized filbert brush and turning the brush so that just the tip of it is touching the canvas for these smaller streaks on the edge. And when I'm doing this, my fingers are at a right angle to the canvas, not parallel to it like they usually are. Bring out that charcoal pencil again. It makes it very easy for me to draw the shapes on correctly because I have more control drawing with a pencil than I do drawing with a brush. I think most people do. I can just draw these shapes on with my pencil and then fill them in later with the paint. Someone once told me, "You don't paint, Sara, you draw and fill in." That's really all painting is drawing and filling in. If you want something to look realistic and lifelike, you're going to be filling in with multiple colors or multiple shades. Whether I'm painting my feathers in the blue part or on the white part, I'm focusing on abstract lines and shapes. Not just painting those U's everywhere that we would all draw feathers as when we were drawing cartoon birds. If anything, my shapes are more like little triangles or like the ends of arrows than they are like U's. I'm painting lines with the tip of my liner brush here, and I use my liner brush all the time in acrylic painting. And I've recently come to realize it's also going to be invaluable in watercolor painting. I'm painting these mostly using wet on dry because I want there to be definite edges on the feathers. In acrylics, it's not so much meaning whether you're painting wet or wet on dry. It's whether you blend out your edges or you don't blend out your edges. And right now, I'm not blending out my edges. I want there to be definite edges there. Now the way I'm painting the feathers mostly is by painting the shapes between the feathers, and in doing this the feathers themselves actually start to come out. This method of painting the shapes between the feathers was challenging, and that's what made it fun for me. But this only works if you're paying close attention to where you're putting things and the shapes that you're making. Again, just like with the watercolor version, I'm painting the shapes between the feathers. And I'm using my liner brush for these, even though the lines aren't super thin, because I need that almost triangular shape. And the round brush, even the smallest one, doesn't give me enough control for that. I think a liner brush is for painting fine detail, not just for painting fine lines necessarily. While working on this, I honed in on those feathers and ignored the rest of the piece, or ignored the rest of the photo. I'm not drawing lines down the middle of each feather and drawing other lines going away from that. That's unnecessary. I'm just painting more shapes here. The shapes I'm painting in this area are very small. They're almost just speck, but the size, shape, and placement is very important. That's why I was talking about earlier about honing in on this specific part of your reference photo. That's the only way you're going to know exactly where to put everything. At least exact enough to where it looks like what you're trying to paint. If a feather is a few centimeters to the left or to the right of where it is in the photo, or if the photo shows a cluster of six feathers somewhere and you have five, that's not a huge deal. But if you're just randomly painting shapes everywhere or repeating the same shape over and over just because it looked good once, you could be wasting your time. When you're doing this much detail, I recommend every few minutes or after every few marks, just take a step back from your canvas. It could be as simple as just putting your brush down and just leaning back in your chair. But just stop every few minutes and look at what you're doing. Because number one, you need to do that anyway to really know how things are going. But also, it can get really tedious doing this much detail. When you step back, you might see that your work is actually looking pretty good, better than you thought it was. As seeing the results your hard work is yielding can be very motivating. At least it is for me. It's also important because you might see that it's not looking so good, and then you need to figure out how you need to pivot. During the process of painting all these feathers, you'll see me stop for about a second or two in between. That's because every time I make a mark, I look at back at the photo to see where to make the next one. You really can't see what I'm doing down this bottom most part when I'm painting curved lines that taper at both ends and are widest in the middle. But they're all pretty thin. Painting those dark separation lines, just like you saw me do in the watercolor version. For the bird's reflection in the water, I'm following the same principles that I've used for the bird himself, which is focusing on lines and abstract shapes. Again, I'm painting it mostly wet on dry, and I'm using my liner brush to paint these dark brown shadows where they're needed. As I was putting some of these marks down, I knew they were too dark, but I put them down anyway. I'm really just using them as placeholders now, and you'll see me go over them again with a lighter color. But then I'm leaving some of that darker color still showing. A big advantage of acrylics that I'm taking advantage of right now is that you can paint light colors over darker colors very easily. I can paint white highlights over this gray, no problem. And in watercolor, if I want to have little details like this, they're going to be white. I have to plan them out ahead of time and make sure I reserve them, because if I don't and they get paint on there, watercolor can lift. You'll never get the paper back to totally white. And that's one of the things that makes working in watercolor difficult for me now, because I'm so used to being able to just add my white highlights as I see them, as opposed to having to plan them out ahead of time. Mentally, painting the feathers in the acrylic version is pretty much the same process as painting in the watercolor version. That's just pay attention to your reference photo. Like I said, just hone in on those feathers. Forget about everything else. I've done 3 other watercolor versus acrylic demonstrations. They're playing on your screen right now. My first one was painting a rose, then I painted a sunset over a lake, and then I painted silk. There's a card in the upper right-hand corner, and they're all linked in the description.
I make art videos every week. You'll find 2 more of them over here. And if you want to keep seeing these, make sure to click here to subscribe so I can help you bring out your creativity.